Okay, so in the last class, we looked at specific types of implementations of specific issues in the implementation of adders, right? One of the things we saw was the transistor level implementation of the full adder cell, that is to say the sum and the carry outputs for a full adder structure. What are the kinds of transistor level implementations that you can come up with, and what are some tricks that you can use in order to optimize those and come up with something which is much smaller than a complete CMOS realization of the same circuit. Okay, and also saw that it's possible by doing some clever layout to actually make the entire full adder cell quite compact so that it can itself be used as a standard cell in a large library. Okay, so now the biggest problem that we saw at the end of the day was that the main structure that you create using full adder cells, when you want to add like multiple bits together, let's say 8 bit numbers, you need to chain these full adders together and you end up with the situation of a ripple carry. That is, the carry can ripple all the way from the least significant bit to the most significant bit. And that is typically the critical path through the circuit, the longest path. Okay, which causes the largest delay in the circuit. So now, a lot of effort has gone into designing better adders with the goal primarily of, can I reduce that critical path? Can I make it shorter? Can I make the adder work faster? Okay, and what we are going to do today is look at some of the techniques that have been used for that. Now, one of the core ideas as far as this whole business of faster adders is concerned is to use the concept of generate and propagate signals. Right? The idea over here is, let's say that you are adding two multi-bit numbers together. Right? So that your overall structure looks something like this. And I'm trying to find out, alright, so I have, let's say, AI and BI coming in here. Okay, I want to find out what are the two things that I want to get from AI and BI. I want to know what is the sum output SI and what is the carry output CI. Right, the missing piece of information over here is the carry input CI minus 1. Okay, and the question becomes, how soon can I get that missing carry input value? Do I need to wait for all the stages before this in order to finish computation before I can get CI minus 1? Or are there cleverer ways by which I can calculate CI minus 1 quickly even before the SI minus 1, SI minus 2, etc. have computed? Okay, so let the sum bits take their own time to calculate. Can the carry bits alone be generated in a faster manner than by rippling all the way from the LSB? That's the question that we are asking. Okay? So, the first observation that we can make is, just consider this full adder, FAI. Right, I full adder in the circuit. What are the possibilities for a carry output to come? Under what conditions will a carry output be generated? So both A and B are equal to 1, that is one possibility. Right? So definitely we have the situation that both A and B are equal to 1. If both A and B are equal to 1, then we definitely have a situation where a carry will be generated. Right? Apart from that, is there any other way by which, supposing either A or B is equal to 0, then under what condition will the carry out become equal to 1? Then CI minus 1 has to become equal to 1. Right? That's the only way that the carry can get generated. Okay. In other words, the first condition is the same as AI and BI. Right? So if AI and BI is equal to 1, it means that technically carry output is equal to 1. Okay? We call this a signal which basically says whether or not a carry is being generated at this stage. Okay? AI and BI are completely local, they don't depend on CI minus 1. So AI and BI both being equal to 1 guarantees that there is a carry out, which essentially says the carry was generated at this stage. It doesn't matter what the value of CI minus 1 was. Okay? So I'll call this signal GI. Here I'll consider AI XOR BI. Only one of them is equal to 1. Okay? I'll call this signal PI, the propagate signal. Okay? So what does the propagate signal mean? It means that there is no carry generated locally because AI and BI are not both equal to 1. If AI and BI are equal to 1, then PI is equal to 0. Right? But on the other hand, GI is equal to 1. So it says that locally there is a carry generated. It is just that you need not consider it as being propagated. That is to say, the input carry, right, PI minus 1, will not get propagated. Okay? So we can effectively write the carry out equation as either the carry was generated locally, that is GI, or there was a carry input PI minus 1 which was then propagated to the output. Okay. How does this work? Essentially what it's saying is either the carry was generated locally, GI, or if CI minus 1 was equal to 1 and propagate signal was equal to 1, then the carry out was equal to 1. But if CI minus 1 is equal to 0, then even if the propagate signal is equal to 1, the output is still equal to 0. That is, in other words, as soon as CI becomes equal to 1, whatever is there in CI minus 1 will come through to the output. Okay? So far I have not really changed anything, I have just defined two new signals. Right, the generate and propagate signals, and all that I'm saying over here is by doing this I can effectively say what happens as a result of two local signals, GI and CI, and the carry input to that state. Okay. Now carry out I have over here, once I have the GI and CI signals, I can also define the sum output using the GI and PI signal, so I don't need to use A and B and CI anymore. I can actually do it using the sum will anyway be generated in the same way as before. Right, I still need to know the carry input over there. Right? So this is the crucial part. The carry out can be written in this form. Okay? Now, so far nothing has changed. I still depend on CI minus 1. So until I have CI minus 1, I cannot calculate CI. Until I have CI, I cannot calculate CI plus 1. The ripple effect is still there. It's just that instead of A and B in the equations, I have replaced them with GI and PI. I have done some pre-computation. Right? Instead of doing AB plus BC plus CA for the C output, I now have G plus C dot CI minus 1. But the G and C themselves require some computation, some logic. Okay. Now, where this becomes interesting is when I start grouping blocks of full adders together. Okay. So let's consider that I have two full adders. I'll consider it as C0, A1, B1, A2, B2. I'm interested in the value C2. And of course the value is S2 and S1. But S2 and S1 are less important. C2 is the one that I'm most concerned with. Okay? Now of course in the normal state of affairs, what happens is that C0 feeds into the first full adder, it generates C1, that in turn feeds into the second full adder and it generates C2. Right? But what I'm going to say is, what if I had also calculated these things? V1 is equal to A1 B1, which means that carry would be generated at the first case. V2 is equal to A2 B2. This means carry is generated at the second stage. It does not depend on the first stage at all. If G2 is equal to A2, B2 is equal to 1, then C2 is straight away equal to 1. I don't need to wait for the result from A1, B1. Okay? There are also two more signals. C1 is A1 XOR B1 and C2 is A2 XOR B2. Now I can define something a bit more interesting. I can basically say the output C2 is high if either G2 is 1 or what are the possible conditions? What's the next possible condition to consider? G2 is 1, okay, that straight away gives us carry output. If G2 is not equal to 1, then I need to consider C2. Right? But what does C2 say? C2 will only propagate through the second stage. So now what is the condition for something to get generated in the first stage? Either it should be generated in the first stage or propagated through the first stage. Right? So one possibility is C2 is equal to 1 and it got generated in the first stage. Or C2 is equal to 1, C1 is equal to 1 and C0 is equal to 1. Okay. Now notice what we have done here. Effectively, I have created a new equation where I am writing C2 directly in terms of C0. C1 is no longer in the picture. Right? This kind of an equation is basically called a look-ahead kind of look-ahead equation or a look-ahead transformation. Right? I know how to express C1 in terms of C0, I know how to express C2 in terms of C1, I plug in the value for C1 in the second equation and straight away get C2 in terms of C0. Okay? So now C2 is dependent on C0, of course it has to be, and other values which are all locally generated, the G1, C1, G2, C2 are all generated just using the A1, B1, A2, B2 system. So if I put in some extra logic which will allow me to directly compute this, or if I am able to implement this in a cleverer fashion, right, then it may be a possibility that I can compute C2 a bit faster than if I directly computed it using the resistor. Okay? Why am I saying maybe? Because I have actually increased the amount of logic here, not that I have actually reduced anything. G2 is still a fairly complex equation, it's dependent on multiple things. Right? But if there was some way by which I could cleverly generate the G2 directly in terms of the C2 directly in terms of C0, then it means that my second stage carry can be generated fast. My ripple delay can be reduced. Okay? So that's the core idea that we use for the rest of the adder structures that we are going to be looking at. Okay. It turns out that there are some very clever ways of implementing this kind of logic, right? The logic chain that I have over here, C2 directly in terms of C0, using pass transistor cells. I'm not going to go into that in class, I'll probably give that as one of the assignment questions. Right? it turns out that using fast transistors you can implement this in a much simpler fashion than using logic. Okay, which means that I can directly compute T2 in terms of T0 with a lesser delay than if I actually go through two full adders. Okay, but that's not the end of the story. That is one particular thing which we'll call the carry look ahead type of adder, which we'll get to again in a moment. Before that, I want to sort of get in a little bit more detail about this particular kind of equation, right? I mean, what else can we do with these equations? So far I saw how I can write G1, G2, T1, T2. I can calculate those values individually and write T2 in terms of T0. Right? Now what I'm saying is, I need not stop there. I can actually define something called a G I colon J. This is a group generate signal. Okay? What does a group generate signal mean? It basically means that there is some group of bits over here. At this end we have A, J through BJ, and at this end we have A and BI. And in between we have many other bits. Okay? And what we are saying is there is overall one GI colon J and TI colon J. GI colon J means somewhere inside this group of bits a carry was generated. And was propagated all the way till GI, till I. Okay? So there is a carry out of this state, of this block of bits. This block of bits from I to J does have a carry out and it was generated locally. Okay? TI colon J says something different. What it says is there was no carry generated locally, but if there was a carry input, then there will be a carry output for this entire block of I colon J bits, that is I minus J plus 1 bits. Okay? So, the interesting thing is how do I write down the equation for G I colon J? Right? What I am going to do is click this somewhere and call this the state value, state bit position. Right? And what I am going to say is, for generating a carry output from the block I colon J, either I should generate something in I colon J or generate something in K minus 1 to J and propagate it from J, from I to K, or rather from K to I. Right? This is almost the same kind of equation that I had earlier. Right? What I have over here. The carry input must either be generated locally or must come in from somewhere and get propagated to the output. Here, the carry input, the carry generate for this says that either I have to generate within I to K or generate somewhere before K but then propagate it all the way through to I. Those are two conditions under which I can generate a carry from this entire block of K. Okay? What does TI say? Or rather TI colon J. For propagating all the way from the input J to the last case I must have propagated all the way from J up to K and then from K up to I. Right? And of these two, that is T of I colon K and T of K minus 1 colon K. Okay? So what has happened over here is are now generated, group, propagate and generate signal. The first one, the G equivalent J, is telling you that somewhere within this group of bits, a carry output for the entire state, for that entire block, is being generated. The P equivalent J is saying, if there was a carry input to this entire block, it will get transferred all the way through to the output. So, another way of looking at these pictures is basically, so this is a set of diagrams that we will be using extensively for analyzing all the remaining adder clusters. Okay? So, what we have over here is the so called black cell where GI colon J and PI colon J are being generated, a grey color cell where we are only interested in GI colon J, we don't really care about the PI colon J. Right. It can be generated, but that's extra logic, as you can see over here. One extra AND gate is required, which we are skipping. Okay. And we also, in the diagrams that follow, we will be making use of buffers. Okay. Now the exact reason for those buffers we'll get to when we actually see the circuit. Why do you want to have buffers in some places and not have buffers in other places? Finally, it comes down to the so-called branching effort. Right? If I have one signal which needs to get connected to many different places, is there a possibility that I can, instead of connecting it directly to all those places, I can connect it to one or more of those places and then put it through a buffer which in turn can drive many other places? When can I do that if the buffer does not come on my critical path? Okay, if I can place a buffer such that the buffer is not on my critical path, then I will always prefer to put a buffer, because then the load on my input driving stage will be ready. Okay? What is a buffer in terms of practical implementation? It will probably be two inverters, one after the other. Okay? Or it might even get collapsed into one particular cell where you optimize the layout so that the two inverters, you compact them together and you get one standard cell which is a buffer which has more or less the same size as an inverter itself. Okay. So buffers can be made in that. Anyway, we'll get to buffers when we need to use them. The point is, right now there are these two different kinds of cells, black cells and grey cells, right? Which we will make use of for the rest of our diagram to understand how they work. Okay. Now, as an example of what the use of these kind of cells is, let's take specifically the case of the ripple carry adder itself. Okay. This is the so-called PG diagram, the propagate generate diagram for a ripple carry adder. Okay. Each of these is a generate cell. Right? It only generates a carry. Okay. So what is this saying? This first one over here is effectively saying that a carry is being generated, that is saying it is determining whether or not a carry is being generated at stage 1. Right? The second one is taking an input from that. The carry out from that first stage, the second one is only concerned about is there a carry generated at the second stage. The third one is saying is there a carry generated at the third stage, fourth stage and so on. Okay. So what you can see over here is that the overall delay goes through all of these stages. This is the regular ripple carry adder. Okay? Where I have not made any tricks in order to speed up the generation of carry. And because of that, what we have on the y-axis is effectively the delay. Right? So whatever we have on the y-axis, the number of stages that you see over there is directly proportional to the overall propagation delay through this entire circuit. Okay? So what we are going to do is move on to the next sort of clever addition that we have over here, right? The first stage of sort of optimizing this kind of logic, optimizing the delay, where we say we will define something called a carry chip adder. Carry chip or carry bypass adder. Okay. So the basic idea behind it is something like this. Let's say that I want to add two 16-bit numbers. The propagation delay is going to be all the way from bit 0 up to bit 15. Okay. Now maybe I can accept the propagation delay from bit 0 up to bit 3. That's a 4-bit adder. That's not too much. I am okay with that. But I would like to reduce the delay from 0 to 15. I don't want it to be the complete 16 times the individual carry propagate delay. Okay? So what we say over here is, let me take two 4-bit adders. Okay? The first one takes the carry input, C0. Finally, I want to generate a carry output from this. So I am considering 8-bit numbers now. So an 8-bit adder composed of two 4-bit stages. Okay? The trick that I am going to use over here is, what is the way by which I can actually get this result over here, right, faster than before? What I'm going to say is, I'll feed in an input from this based on a multiplexer. Okay? Either I need to feed in the carry which is generated over here, let's go to this diagram, right? What we have over here is a 16-bit adder consisting of four 4-bit stages, right? The first stage that you can see over here is adding 4 bits, right? 4:1. The second one is adding 8:5, then 12:9 and 16:13. Okay? What I do is I put some propagate logic over here. Right? And I say, if the carry in was equal to 1 and the propagate logic says that it is supposed to get propagated through this entire stage, straight away send the signal through. Okay? Remember, what was the worst case as far as the ripple carry adder was concerned? In the ripple carry adder, the problem was C0 goes through C1, C2, C3, C4, then goes to C5, C6, C7, C8, then to C9, C10 and so on. Okay? Supposing the carry was generated somewhere in between, that is instead of C0 rippling all the way through, let's say it was only generated at C2, then the delay is a bit less. It is not as bad as what happened in the case of rippling all the way from the input to the output. Okay? That worst case, that rippling through all stages is what we are trying to bypass over here. Right? We consider the propagate logic, C4 colon 1. What does that say? If C4 colon 1 is equal to 1, it means that the carry input is going to get propagated all the way through to the output. In other words, you are going to ripple through all the 4 stages. Okay? So what do? You bypass it. You straight away take that carry input, put it through this path, and short circuit it to the next stage. There is still a path where CL will go through this entire logic and then come out over here and so on. But because of the multiplexer, I'm not going to bother about that. I'm going to straight away take the propagate signal and say, look, this had to get propagated in any case. So just switch over to that. Okay? For the second block of 4 bits, also I do the same thing. If C8 colon 5 is equal to 1, then C4 is directly getting shunted through over here. It will bypass the entire adder and go through to the output stage. After some time, the S8 colon 5 will get computed and also the C8 colon 5, the actual value which was supposed to get generated over there, will also be generated. But it doesn't matter. By the time I've already bypassed it and reached the output stage. Okay? Same way for 12 colon 9 and 16 colon 13. So by making use of these 4 multiplexers, effectively what I have done is, I have managed to cut down that critical ripple carry path. In the worst case where the carry ripples all the way from input to output, I have managed to break it down so that it essentially gets reduced. The path through the entire circuit gets ready. Okay? The propagate generate diagram for this looks something like this. Right? As far as the first one is concerned, this is a ripple carry path. But these, in the meantime, are calculating C4 colon 1. Okay, and based on that, this multiplexer will straight away say, okay, which of those 2 carries is supposed to go through to the next stage. Once it goes through to the next stage, it can also get bypassed one more stage. Right, and then one more stage and then one more stage. So this long path that I have marked in red would have normally been the ripple carry path. Okay? But it has been completely bypassed in the worst case. And the only delay that you have is essentially through these multiplexers instead of through all the adders. Look at the delay. A multiplexer delay is also going to be fairly small, right? Because a multiplexer, if anything, is even simpler to implement than a full adder. Okay? So the overall delay, if you just count the number of stages, that itself you can see visually that it is much less than what it was in the case of the ripple carry adder, right? Probably around half in this case. Okay, so you can bring down the delay significantly. Now this becomes even more important when you go for, let's say, 32 bit adders or 64 bit adders, right? In fact, when you go for certain kinds of the PlayStation console and some kind of specific processors like that, had conditions where they require 128 bit adders. Okay, yeah. Yeah. C4 will get computed only after this adder has finished its work and given out carry out. Yes. Yes. It wastes. So of course, the multiplexer will initially give a wrong value. The P8 colon 5, the adder at 8 colon 5 might do some unnecessary work, it doesn't matter. In combinational logic that is always the case, right? If you give the wrong value to start with and after some propagation delay you correct it to the correct value, then the other combinational block would have done some wasted work, which will then get corrected. So that is there also. No, it will never be 16 full adders. The only way that it can become 16 full adders is because you have a propagate through a chain of 4. As soon as you have a propagate through a chain of 4, that propagate signal will come and that multiplexer will be activated. It will straight away take the delay through that. It will bypass that entire block. So you can never get a single path which passes through all 16 full adders. Okay, yeah. Yeah. You are not even considering the generate signal here. In this case, you don't need to care about the generate signal. All that you are interested in is, for a block of 4 bits at a time, can I bypass that entire block? Can I take the carry input and straight away send it through to the carry output? If that cannot happen, then the carry will get generated somewhere internally. But that's okay, that will be at most 3 states. No, it will not. It will come out to be the same thing. So what will happen is anyway you have to, so in this diagram for example, this first part, right, the first three blocks that you have over there has to get computed for both. After that is done, what we are saying is either the carry will get directly propagated through each stage or it will go into this one, right, and then it will get generated somewhere locally in there and the computation will happen. So it will only pass through any, at any given point it will only pass through individual blocks. So the overall propagation delay will be less than in the world. Okay? How will you know the relative timing of? Sorry, I am not able to hear you. There is no question of when do you read it. These are all combinational blocks, right? So how does a combinational block work? Let's say an inverter. Anytime I change its input, after some propagation delay, the output will change. So as far as combinational logic is concerned, at any point in time, if the input changes, after some propagation delay, the output will change. Okay? So now how does it work for this overall thing? That is why we are saying that the actual delay through this is the number of levels. Because we can go to the first level. First level inputs are being given from outside. After that propagation delay of the first level, you can be sure that the first level will never change again. After the first level has finished, second level. Once the second level has computed, you can be sure it will never change again. Then the third level, then the fourth level. So we are going in that level order fashion, one after the other. That's why we are drawing it in so many different states. And we are saying that only after the I level is complete, I plus 1 level can start. In reality, it may actually be a bit faster than that. But we are considering the worst case. When the I level finishes, then the I plus 1 level starts. But that's one thing to always keep in mind. this something finishing and then the next one starting is only something we are using to make it easier for us to understand. In reality, they are combinational blocks. Anytime their inputs are changing, their outputs will change. If the input changes unnecessarily, the output will also change. And there will be one unnecessary change which will change back later. Okay? This, by the way, is an example of a false path. Right? You can see that there are two paths through the circuit. There is one which passes through the entire full adder, the 4-bit adder. The other which passes through the multiplexer. The multiplexer effectively plays the role of generating that false path. Because at any given point in time, either the select input to the multiplexer is low, in which case propagation is not happening and you actually have to ripple through all the stages. Or, in the worst case, when the ripple would have gone through all four stages, the select input to the multiplexer will already be 1 and will bypass that entire stage. Okay? So if you do a static timing analysis on this circuit, you will actually get a critical path of full 16 ripple carry. Right? But because of the multiplexers, at any given point in time, only one of those two paths can be active. In the worst case, when it is going through all the four stages, the multiplexer will be active, the multiplexer will be 1 and will automatically bypass that circuit. So that particular path, which involves rippling all the way from input to output and then going through the multiplexer, is bypassed completely. Okay? So this is an example, a real life example where false paths do come into the picture. The output definitely does depend on the input, right? So it's not a question of something where you can just optimize the logic away. You have specifically introduced it with the aid of a multiplexer in order to achieve a certain task. But the multiplexer introduces a false path into the circuit. Okay? Like I said, the PG diagram of this looks this way. Right? The first three stages have to ripple through. But after that, it is possible to just bypass through multiplexers all the way through to the final stage. Okay? Now, if you look carefully at this diagram, there is something more that you can observe. Look at the gaps over here. Those initial stages where the addition is happening through that first stage, right? So what's happening over there? Those three blocks over there are saying T8:5 is doing some computation, right? That corresponds to the generation. Then once the carry reaches over there, once again it has to do a computation before generating the final output. Okay? But it's doing this computation and then there is a big gap before the multiplexer input comes in. And the gap is increasing with time. If I had a 32-bit adder, that gap would get significantly larger as I go further over there. What can you do about it? Why is this gap happening and how can you sort of reduce it? First of all, why is the gap coming?
Because we have computed those three stages, then there is a multiplexer, which will add one more level, effectively. Okay? Which we have not taken into account over there. So suppose in a unit server, the first stage has only 2 instead of 3. Then the 2 level addition of the first stage, followed by the multiplexer, would have matched up completely with the 3 levels of the second stage. I can then match that with 4 levels in the 3rd stage, 5 levels in the 4th stage and so on.
Okay? So this is what the diagram will look like if I do that.
Right? I have this 2 levels in the 1st stage. Then I increase around 1 level in the 1st stage, then 2, then 3. But after that, I need to look at the bottom part. Once I have reached up to a certain value, I now need to look at the lower part of the circuit and say I need to balance that also. Otherwise, I would have got that top part balance, so there will be huge delay coming over here.
Okay. Effectively, what ends up happening is, the optimal way of doing it is to say, I'll have one stage plus two stages plus three plus four up to something, and then again decrease. Okay, such that all of this put together becomes equal to n, where n is the number of bits in the array. Okay, so let's say it goes up to some p. What will be the value of p? Let's say I want to find p such that 1 plus 2 plus 3 up to p and then down to 1 is equal to n. Approximately square root of n. Right? So how do we get that? Essentially what we have is something like p into p plus 1 by 2 is the sum of the first n stages plus p into p minus 1 by 2. Right? So this basically becomes equal to p square. Why approximately? Because you are unlikely to find the value of p which is exactly, in other words, unless n is an exact square, you cannot find the value of p which is exactly required for it. Okay? So now what does that tell you about the overall delay through the circuit? The overall delay through the carry bypass adder, if you design it properly, can be made proportional to square root of n. Okay? Alright, we'll stop here for now. We need to continue this. There is some more to be discussed on the topic of adder. We'll continue that on Monday.